Quick note before we get into this video, like last year, I'm currently translating a German primary source from World War II together with MHUE. It's the army pamphlet of the assault platoon of the Grenadier Company from November of 1944, giving you all a great source of information how the Germans envisioned the tactical use of the Sturmgewehr STG 44. If you want to get your hands on this book, visit the link in the description below. Hey everybody, Chris here from Military Aviation History. And I've just been going through some of the footage we filmed in Munich for the Inside the Cockpit episode on the F-104 Starfighter. And I came across this clip that I actually took with my phone. This was something that we did while preparing for the shoot. And it is opening the access panels here to the M61A1 rotary 20mm cannon. You can already see the quick access hatch opening there that actually does not come off fully unless you want it to come off fully, but that gives you access to the overall gun assembly, while the one that we are opening up here gives you access to the barrels. Now the M61, the A1, which the Starfighter carries, obviously a 20mm caliber. It fires a 20x102mm cartridge. And it does so at about a rate of 6,000 rounds a minute, although the manual actually says 4,000. And there's of course also the A2 variant of the weapon, which is slightly lighter and has a slightly upped fire rate, but that's not the one that's installed here. Now these screws that are being let loose here are sort of these spring-loaded quick-release screws, I guess you would call them. Usually they come off quite easily. You just push in, you turn, they pop out. Sometimes you have to help a little bit, but it allows you to get access relatively quickly. Now, one of them is still closed on top, obviously, otherwise this panel would be falling through now. And in order to do this correctly, you have to push in the panel now, open up that last one, and there you go. You've got full access to the barrel assembly of the rotary gun. Quite a long weapon, weighs about 110 kilograms. I believe that translates to roughly 250 pounds. Now that it is uncovered, let's have a closer look at the gun and its development. The General Electric M61 Vulcan is a 6-barrel 20mm cannon used in a wide variety of American combat aircraft during the Cold War and continues to see service. Used as a fixed offensive weapon, it was also put on some variants of, for example, the Convair B-58 Hustler and the B-52 Stratofortress as defensive firepower. It was also quickly adopted outside of the aerial domain, and variants of the weapon also see application in other systems like armored vehicles or on ships. Development harks back to the end of World War II. With some exceptions like the P-38 Lightning, most US American aircraft during the war used the M2 Browning, the famous 50 cal, as their armament of choice. Considering the context of World War II, this was a relatively solid choice for the US armed forces. However, the World War M2 50 cal did have a fire rate that did not exceed around about 800 rounds a minute. During the conflict, this was fine. Later on, the changing nature of aerial combat demanded an increased fire rate and also more destructive rounds. The M3 Browning bumped up the fire rate to about 1,200 rounds a minute and saw service in planes like the F-86 Sabre. For the type of weapon it was, this fire rate increase was a respectable performance, but combat experience over Korea showed that the M3's fire rate was still lacking and that the destructive capability of the shells was not good enough. Commonly, the Korean experience is taken as the instance where the US started to think about adopting a higher caliber weapon. In actual fact, by the time of the Korean War, development of such new weapons were already going on. In 1946, the General Electric Company was awarded the Project Vulcan contract. Chosen for this design was a Gatling gun style device. On the surface, this was a step back. Gatling guns had gone out of favor even before World War I. In the mid-19th century, the model 1862 was demonstrated by its inventor Richard Gatling, hence the name, in Indianapolis, Indiana. He applied for a patent in 1862, and subsequent models were generally named after the year that they were completed in. With this weapon, a fire rate of 200 rounds a minute could be achieved, which during the time of the US Civil War was a blistering fire rate for a single device. Within about 20 years, this would have increased, as new models achieved a fire rate of 1000 rounds a minute or more. If you are interested in Gatling guns, at the end of this video I will also be linking a great episode from Ian over at Forgotten Weapons, where he presents one of the many Gatling guns that developed over time. The Gatling had eventually been developed to its zenith based on the technology at the time, and fell out of favor as the automatic machine gun appeared on the scene. Its potential, however, was remembered, and General Electric brought the Gatling principle into the 20th century, as in 1950 it delivered the first T-45 prototypes for evaluation. The Korean War had not yet started at this point. Over the next years, three calibers were tested: 60 cal, roughly 15mm, 20mm, and 27mm. Already redesignated as the T-171, the 20mm gun was selected and put on track for further development, and by 1956, both the US Army and the US Air Force standardized on the new M61 20mm Vulcan aircraft gun. By now, the weapon had achieved devastating fire rates, jumping through the iterations from 2000, 2500 to 4000 rounds a minute. Later this would also be improved, as we will see. It's worth noting that the M61 had some competition. For example, the Ford Motor Company M39 revolver cannon, which fired the same 20x102mm cartridge. As a single barrel revolver cannon, its fire rate was a lot lower, although it had some advantages in terms of weight, accuracy, and immediate fire rate when pressing the trigger. The M39 was in service on the F-100 Super Sabre, the F-101 Voodoo, and also on the F-5 Freedom Fighter and later Tiger II. Back to the M61 then. The F-104 and F-105 development teams adopted this as their weapon of choice, and a linkless ammunition feed system was developed. The basic components are the following: the housing, the firing contact assembly, the rotor assembly inside the housing, the recoil adapters, the barrels, the mid-barrel clamp, and the muzzle clamp assembly. When power is applied to the firing contact assembly and the gun driver unit, the firing cycle starts. The gun is hydraulically driven by a 20 horsepower electric motor, which drives a rotor mounted to the six 20mm barrels. As it rotates, the bolt of each rotating barrel opens and closes once each revolution, allowing a round to be chambered and fired. The empty cases are extracted after the round has left the barrel. With a selectable fire rate, the gun can be set to different settings like 4000 or 6000 rounds a minute, and a 7200 rounds a minute setting is also possible. However, usually a setting of 6000 is preferred in the aerial role, although some manuals indicate a lower setting of 4000 in some aircraft. These two settings are the main ones, and they're known as gun low and gun high. As the six barrels fire one after the other in quick succession, each barrel cools itself during the rotation. With time, the M61A1 you see here was improved upon with the M61A2, a lightened version. In this iteration, the gun sees service in aircraft like the FA-18 Super Hornet or the F-22 Raptor. Please let me know if you are interested in more videos like this one, where I specifically look at aerial armament. At that point, I can also go into more detail. Stay tuned for the Inside the Cockpit episode on the F-104 Starfighter. It's going to be a good one. I want to thank the Deutsche Museum in the Flugwerft Schleißheim for their great access to this machine, and of course my Patreons and channel supporters to make travel to these museums feasible. If you enjoy the content and it's possible for you, consider supporting the channel. Please share the video, word of mouth is incredibly important, and remember to subscribe and enabling notifications to not miss future episodes. And as always, have a great day and see you in the sky.